A very good evening to the all ladies and gentlemen and all the viewers today. It's a pleasure welcoming you all in the second edition of Orange City Literature Fest organized by SGR Knowledge Foundation. I am Tufail Sharif, your anchor for this session, and this session is the last day for our session. We will be discussing about the surprising attitude towards the literacy of leaders with none other my ideal Mr. Salman Khurshid sir. Salman sir is a senior advocate in the Supreme Court of India. He is a former Minister of External Affairs, Law and Justice and Corporate Affairs for the Government of India. He is a renowned author, well-known public figure and member of the Indian National Congress as well as honorary fellow of his alma mater, Sir Edmund Hall, University of Oxford. We are extremely honored, sir, to welcome you, sir. I shall now introduce the moderator for this session, Radhika Dhawad ma'am. Radhika ma'am is a senior journalist who has been covering politics of Maharashtra and India at large for more than 6 years. She is associated with Nation Next News Hub for News India. Also, as its deputy editor, has been deconstructing Indian polity for the nation's youth audience, and through her indulgent political reportage and interactive sessions with the senior politicians across the country. We are glad and we welcome you, ma'am. Without taking much of the time, I hand over the session over to you, ma'am. Radhika, ma'am.
Thank you so much. And hello, everybody. Today, we are going to discuss the surprising attitude towards literacy of leaders with Salman, sir. A very warm welcome, sir.
Thank you.
Sir, I want to ask you, in our democracy, there's a huge contrast between leaders as well as voters. Like, on one hand, we have leaders like you, like highly educated leaders. I mean, you are a profound thinker and writer who has studied in the Oxford University. And on the other hand, we have leaders who are not so educated. I mean, some are not even literate. And similarly, we have some highly educated voters, and then we have some illiterate voters as well. Sir, do you think this is one of the biggest dichotomies of the Indian democracy? I'm not visible.
I think there's some difficulty, but I've been able to hear you, so we can carry on. I'm sure the connectivity will in due course come right back. If are other people able to see us? Is Tufail, are you able to see us?
Yeah, I am able to see.
Yes, sir. You both are clearly
all
visible.
Right, good. I think so. There'll be hits and misses in between. I think we should ignore it. As long as the voice travels, I think we'll be fine. Now, the question that you ask is, let me preface it by an interesting anecdote from the time I fought my first election. I was completely a raw hand. I was, if you like, inexperienced. And a very experienced candidate fighting election next door to me introduced me to a crowd after we had all filed our nomination papers. And I was described as someone who was educated. And then after a pause, that beautiful phrase which said, perhaps too educated. But here he is for you, almost as though I was supposed to be mashed up for being educated, and I do not resent that description, because after all these years, 40 years of experience in public life, I've come to figure out that although education and literacy should be an advantage in the world anywhere, and I see no exception for India. But the ground reality is that either your literacy makes you a misfit in the rough and tumble of politics in our country, or people become a little bit skeptical about you because of your literacy. Because there is a strange description of something called being political, that the criticism that somebody might get, worst kind of criticism is, well, he doesn't behave in a political manner. He doesn't seem to understand politics, etc. And so if politics is like the lowest common denominator, then frankly, it's a frightening thing. I mean, this is the same land, and I don't want to be uncharitable or unfair to anyone. But at least in praising, I can highlight the attributes of people like Dr. Radhakrishnan, if you like, somebody who was not in politics but was in public life as our president. Our first Prime Minister, Pandit Nehru, in politics and a hardcore politician in that sense. But if I could write like Pandit Nehru, or if I could speak like Pandit Nehru, I would consider myself ever so blessed. And that was the man who dreamt of an India, and everybody adored him, including that red rose that he put in his Sherwani button. That today would be such a person, today would be a parody of a politician, because you have to be, pardon my saying so, a little bit uncouth. You have to be a little bit rough. You have to be either an entertainer of sorts at the Nautanki level, or you have to be a little bit of a larger than life, fearsome character. So demands of politics is when people say you have to go and become a grassroots politician, I've never been able to understand why that is said. Sitting in a library reading a book is not grassroots, but trudging the fields and shouting slogans in the streets and obstructing traffic and making a general nuisance of yourself, you become grassroots. So literacy and refinement has become a disadvantage, it seems. More the pity. But well, what to do? Let's not forget that there was a time when Phulan Devi won an election to parliament, and I think that was the time that Dr. Manmohan Singh couldn't win from a constituency of South Delhi. There couldn't have been a better, more educated, more upmarket, a modern constituency in South Delhi, and he couldn't make it. But Phulan Devi had made it from Badaun or wherever. So that's an irony that we have to live with.
Sir, but even talking about the same irony, I would just like to point out that somebody like Dr. B.R. Ambedkar and Dr. Shrikant Jitkar, who was the most qualified person in India, even they both had lost elections.
Well, precisely. I would be extremely sorry if the great thinker Dr. Ambedkar, and a great reformist and the constitutional expert that we cherish and value and we think in the highest terms that one can, if Dr. Ambedkar had to fight elections today, my God, I would be really sorry. Dr. Jitkar, I'm so sorry that he passed away too early in his life. I know that he had a mountain of degrees from BA to MA to PhDs all over, and he was quite a remarkable person. What a shame that we lost him very early in life. But yes, as you said, the fact that you have a PhD, or the fact that you have many papers written or books written, doesn't necessarily assure you of a seat. But I must, on the other hand, say that I have a friend and a friend who is second to none in terms of literary merit and in terms of his ability to use words and to write books, and that's Shashi Tharoor. But you know, Shashi Tharoor had to travel to Kerala, which is of course his home state. He had to travel to Kerala to Thiruvananthapuram to win an election, and not just one, but several times. I hate to think what Shashi would have had to do if he came and fought from my state of Uttar Pradesh.
You have been interacting heavily with leaders across political spectrum, and there's a general perception by and large that politicians somewhere get benefited illiterate voters, because beyond a point they cannot question the performance of their leaders. So do these politicians exist?
I'm not worried at all about illiteracy. I mean, illiteracy is not a good thing, but I have met the most remarkable people who are illiterates in a sense. They can't read and write, but whose experience of life, particularly experience of life at the level, at the ground level, is amazing. And their ability to sift the good from the bad, quality of politicians and performance of politicians is absolutely remarkable. But those people are becoming few and far between now, unfortunately. When I started politics, I used to come across enormous number of such people, hugely experienced, very, very, in the sense, very, very intellectual in that sense. But that seems to be disappearing. And now to have a person who's got degrees to flaunt, but whose conduct and responses are sadly uneducated. So the difference now is not so much on illiteracy, the difference is on being uneducated, or the educated uneducated. That's the problem, where the baser things in life seem to matter much more. But to think that a person who is not literate cannot judge a person who would be right to be leading them to be in political office is a misnomer. I think it's a mistake. There may be a few people, but I think largely it doesn't matter. You just have to be. You have to be the right kind of good human being to be able to find the right person to lead the country, to lead you, and to protect the destiny of your children.
Opinion, can the not so literate or not that educated people identify themselves with highly educated leaders? Who are one of the examples? And maybe you can analyze this better.
Well, that's really putting the cat amongst the pigeons, frankly. Yes, it's difficult, but why do people identify with someone? That's a very, very difficult subject, difficult question to answer. I mean, people, how many people identify with Amitabh Bachchan, and how many people identified with Balraj Sahni, as we see in the pantheon of actors, how many people identified with Irfan, who passed away, unfortunately, very early in life, and how many people identify with some of the recent non-heroic kind of Bollywood stars? What makes you reach out for a dancer, entertainer, as against a very, very serious, or even a comic actor, but a profound actor, a great actor, a good actor. Now, the same thing, I suppose, happens in public life, is the choice you make. Why do you make a choice? Normally, one assumes that you try to follow someone that you want to be. So I would imagine the natural instinct would be, I want to be gracious, I want to be good at speeches, I want to be good in my demeanor. I want to sound educated. My language must be literate. And therefore, I find X that I need to follow. But I mean, there are alternative models. They are the TUG model, the Tuffy model, the fly-by-night model. There's a quick on making money model, etc. Politics is full of all kinds of people. So who follows whom is what there is apparent for you to see. And I don't need to tell you that. But yes, as on a personal note, it does sometimes seem that it's very difficult to be able to persuade people that being decent, being rational, being gentle, being analytical, being objective, are the features that would persuade people to follow you. It's becoming more and more difficult. And I do hope, and I sincerely hope that there will be, the wheel will turn again, and that things will change.
So Dr. V.R. Ambedkar had once said that people usually commit two mistakes vis-a-vis literacy. The first is the belief that a literate person is unintelligent. And second is that literacy implies having more knowledge and intelligence than the illiterate person. So against the backdrop of these comments, do you feel that literacy and education are actually true criteria for filtering candidates for leadership?
I'm afraid I preempted your question because I've already indicated to some extent that I don't believe that a person who doesn't have a formal degree is less able to assess someone who is, so to speak, educated. I believe experience is the best education, and experienced people, as I have known in the early years of my life in politics, are remarkable in their being able to assess the good and bad and the promising part of political candidature. So we should never think that someone who is not who doesn't have a formal degree or formal education would be in any way less capable of making a correct assessment about the quality of leadership the country needs or that person himself or herself needs. And therefore, Dr. Ambedkar, I think all these decades ago put his finger on, I believe, the truth that you should not be dismissive of somebody who's not formally educated, but then he shouldn't be someone who's been shut up in a room. He should be someone who's had free access to the experience of life and able to apply that experience of life to their decision making about right and wrong, good and bad for public office.
So if we impose a criteria of encouraging only literate people contest elections, do we somewhere take away the chances of from the most vulnerable class, which include the Dalits, women, and even people from the tribal background, to a chance of representing their people, representing the people, or even governing the country?
I agree with you. It would be horrible, terrible, if somebody is excluded only because of their social background or because they have not had the education that other people may have had. Now, somebody not having education is no fault of theirs. It's the fault of our system. And somebody who has not had the education and has been therefore deprived may be in a much better position to be able to address the deprivation that they have suffered and others like them have suffered. So excluding them, as some people have periodically suggested that there should be an educational barometer for deciding who can fight elections and so on, I'm against that. I don't agree with that at all. I believe, as I'm saying again and again, that experience is what counts. And there is absolutely no justification in excluding anybody. Just as there is no justification for excluding anybody from voting, there is no justification for excluding anybody from contesting elections and for political office. And this is what will change. People who will get elected and come, as indeed is happening elsewhere too, is that the next generation is being encouraged to be educated. Next generation will probably be more serious about education if their uneducated parents have a chance to break the glass ceiling. And I think that's most important for an egalitarian, exclusive community and society, that people be given a chance, irrespective of what chances they've had in life up to that point. If they can persuade enough people to go along with them, vote for them and support them, I think that should be encouraged.
Exactly like we just discussed, that there is no criteria for educational requirement to contest elections, but there is a criteria of age. How do you look at this?
Well, the criteria of age is a very minor criteria, that you have to be of a certain age. You can get your vote when you're a certain age. You can get your first, you can fight your election for assembly and parliament when you're a certain age, which is 25. And of course, you can get into Rajya Sabha when you're 35. So I think that's a rational distinction that is being made. And I believe that you can't cry too much about it. You should have some years behind. You should not be green. You should not be wet behind your ears. You should have some age to back you up, as it were, before you go into representing the vast country that we are.
So people usually look for certain qualities in their leaders. I mean, they want their leader to be empathetic, sympathetic. They should be approachable. They should be able to understand their situation better. Do you think these qualities are subjective in nature? I mean, even illiterates can possess these qualities, maybe in different capacities.
Yeah, I know. Absolutely. There's no reason why they shouldn't. And they don't. the important thing is, what kind of human being can provide you a leadership? And is a leader like an ATM machine, that you press the button, you put a coin, and you get whatever you want. I mean, you go into a vending machine and you press a button and you get a chocolate bar, or you get a can of soft drinks, etc. That's not what a leader is. A leader must also lead from the front. I mean, you're not going to be a leader only as a facilitator. You're a leader because you can think for yourself and you can think for your people who support you and who back you, because they can't think all the time on everything, and they have, by way of education or experience, they may have experience and be equipped to think in certain areas, but they may not be able to think in certain areas. And it is for the leader then to be able to lead from the front, show them the path. And if you are unwilling to show them the path and you just want to follow the crowds, then you're not really much of a leader, are you?
Can we say that the agenda of 100% literacy in our country is somewhere on the back burner today, or is it actually the prime focus of leaders at large today?
Well, sadly, it's not enough of a concern expressed in leaders, amongst leaders. But I think the structures of our policies do point in that direction. And that's what we must do, because literacy has a lot to do with the facilities of digitalization that are now being made vastly and expansively available for everything, for healthcare, for food, for job registrations, for school registrations, etc. And therefore, being literate, even if to a limited extent, being literate is very important, that we should be. And I mean, we are on our way, but I think we've got to move faster and ensure that there is 100% literacy.
So former Chief Minister of Rajasthan, Vasundhara Raje, was the first one to fix the educational requirements for the post of Sarpanch. Like, they had to be at least 10th pass to contest elections. I mean, maybe the good side of this would be that people would actually be motivated to study further. But there can be a flip side. There could have been a flip side. So people might feel that they might feel neglected. They might feel that
she's a very vastly experienced leader, but my view is somewhat different. I think we in India tend to overstate regulation for everything. We want to make rules and regulations for everything. You want to keep a pet, now you have to go and register. If you have an exotic bird that you're allowed to keep, you now before December have to go and register it. Now, if someone gifts you a bird after December and January, February, then all hell will break loose because it doesn't have a certificate. So keep showing certificates everywhere. It's a little bit tedious. It's a little bit tedious. But in every field, there can be an incentive. We can give an incentive to people to get educated so that they can contest elections. But we should not have any exclusionary rules that if you don't have this, then you can't contest. Maybe you're educated, maybe you can get some extra assistance from government of the day to actually contest elections. Something of that nature can be done. But there is a flip side, and the flip side is that the uneducated will say, why are you discriminating against me? And the courts may strike it down. So you'll have to go very carefully about this.
There's a huge ongoing debate as people say that the level of education is actually a reflection of one's capabilities. Of course, you are extremely educated. I mean, how do you look at this?
I think that there's no easy answer to matching the qualities that you are able to imbibe and the content that gets into your mind by being educated. There's no easy parallel or easy alternative to this. Otherwise, why would we all trouble ourselves so much with education? We must ensure that more and more people, as you just talked about 100% literacy, more and more people have access to education, but good education. And good education is not only about rote. It's not only about knowing where the book is. It's also about learning values. Humanism and recognizing humanism and cultivating humanism is also education. So education that is bad is perhaps the worst enemy of education. So good education, value-added education, an education that sensitizes you, education that makes you a wholesome, good person, is the kind of education that we must seek. Not just a certificate and then go wild with your unrestricted characteristics.
So would an educated minister at a local level be able to deliver better, understand people better, or a person for the same post is able to understand his people's problems better, deliver better, understand better? Who do you think, an illiterate person?
Well, I think that there is this romantic thing about the person who lives in the forest is the best person to understand the forest. Yes, of course, they have enormous contribution to make. So the tribal, the agriculturist, the person who tills the fields, the person who lives in the forest, the person who is close to the ground by nature, has enormous knowledge that they can contribute. And India has always celebrated the knowledge that we get from the ground. whether it's knowledge of medicine or it's knowledge of whatever kind, but we've always cherished the natural knowledge that you can get from nature. And we have celebrated nature as an educator, as a great educator. The experiments in Jamia Millia, for instance, of Mahatma Gandhi's Vardha scheme was to make children, and this is now a very important part of modern education, is to make children learn from interacting with nature. To have classrooms without walls, that's the latest description of that kind of quality of education. So there is an enormous thing that that person on the ground can offer to you, no matter in which area that person is active. But look at how we manage governance. We have the best educated people who then sit a very tough competitive exam and become IAS officers. And they look after the district like a father figure. A very young man at the age of 24, 25, 26 lands up as a district magistrate. And he deals with every problem within days of joining there. He deals with every problem of the city, including the difficult politicians. And he has this charm, he has the capacity, ability, training, knowledge, etc., and he knows the district like the back of his hand. And you know that within weeks of being posted there, he's the master of that district. If he has time, he could go back and sit back and write a book or write a thesis, and there would be no better record available for anyone who wants to learn about that district, about the products of that district, about the people, their customs, the religions, the festivals, the police arrangements, the gangsters of that place, etc. All this knowledge could be unloaded in a book form if the magistrate had time after he leaves that district to go in and put pen to paper.
That was exactly my last question that I was going to ask you. That more often than not, we've seen that highly educated officers like IAS, IPS, IRS, they are often seen working and succumbing to leaders in cities. I mean, some are educated, some are not educated. So at the most, what happens is either there is a synergy, they work in coherence, or else what happens, the governance goes for a toss.
Yeah.
This is an irony, but what do you think actually happens at the ground level? What is the ground reality?
What you need to do is to see the television serial, Yes Minister. And you will enjoy that as to how civil servants in the same system, I mean, the British system and ours is the same, we follow that system, how the civil servant deals with ministers. So ministers are cut out for doing something quite different from the civil servant. The civil servant is trained to do things in a manner in which he would carry out the political policy choices of the minister, but within the four walls of the law, as he's being trained to apply to any decision that he has to take. And don't forget that sometimes civil servants get so upset and angry and distressed that they leave the civil service and join politics. And they've been known to become chief ministers, Mr. Jogi. In Madhya Pradesh, but later on, of course, Chhattisgarh went on to become the chief minister, and this has happened with other people as well. So that I think it's an evolving situation, and some people remain civil servants all their life and become a very solid support to the politicians. And you see various prime ministers we've had in this country and how strongly their administrative staff has supported them and become indistinguishable from the prime minister and from the ministers concerned.
Thank you so much, sir. And thank you so much for your time. And this interaction could not have been any better.
Thank you very much. I enjoyed it thoroughly. I must apologize to all your subscribers that we had to change time. And we had to change time because I was asked by a former prime minister to be present for an important meeting. It so happened that that got changed and that meeting was cancelled. But I didn't want to disturb your arrangements all over again. The first shift to 7 o'clock and then say, I can go back to 6 o'clock. So if anyone's missed out, anyone's been inconvenienced, very sorry, but thank you very much. I enjoyed, thoroughly enjoyed.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Shall I proceed with the formal vote of thanks?
Sure.
Before I proceed with a formal vote of thanks, I am a big fan and a huge follower of Mr. Salman Khurshid, sir. Belonging to the legal fraternity, today I am taking a lot of things with me. Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful session. And thank you so much, Radhika ma'am, for moderating session very beautifully. We are glad that to having all beautiful and experienced personality with us. So on behalf of Orange City Literature Festival, we sincerely express our gratitude towards your acceptance for the session and knowledge shared with us. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you
well,
so much.
Well, thank you very much. I was looking forward to a lot of questions on literature. You ended up asking me questions on literacy. So for another day, maybe we'll talk on literature.
Yes, for okay. Sure.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Delighted. And all the best to you. All the best.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Twenty years of existence. Two universities. 23 educational institutes. Offering 137 courses. Thy Sony Group of Institutions. A vision beyond.